So how bold are your prayers? How bold are your prayers? You know, what are you praying for right now that requires a supernatural move of God? What's on your prayer list that requires something supernatural, something that you're praying for boldly? You know, quite honest, a lot of people don't pray bold prayers because we struggle to believe that God would actually move on our behalf. We struggle to actually believe that God can do something on what's on our hearts to pray for. And you know, sometimes those of you who have been here for any length of time would have heard me in my little rant about be with prayers. And you know, so we pray, Lord, be with that sick person. Lord, be with that person who has cancer. Lord, be with that person. He's already with them. What are we praying for? Lord, heal them. Lord, touch them. Do we pray bold prayers? Lord, would we pray prayers that give God the glory because He has to move in power? That's a bold prayer. You know, prayer is actually an outflow of our relationship with God. Prayer has to come from relationship. So how bold is your prayer life? You know, last week, as we're going through John's letter, first letter to the church in Asia Minor, and last week we kind of turned the corner because the first part of the letter is all about God is light. God is light. And that kind of sets the stage for the second part, which we turned to last week. God is love. God is love. So God is transcendent. He is light. To God is right here with us. He is love. And the boldness of our prayers come from the faith in truly believing that God is love, that He's good, that He's wanting to answer our prayers, that we're abiding or rooted in the promises of God's Word, and more about that later. But today my objective is so that we would leave this place praying bold prayers, or leave this place with the expectation that when we pray, God's going to move on our behalf. How many of you for that today? Let's pray boldly. You know, the Bible frequently talks about the human heart. The Bible frequently mentions the heart. And the Bible's not talking about the organ that's in our chest that moves our blood around and that we're concerned if it beats too high or concerned if it beats too low. No, the Bible's talking about is the essence of who we are. Our heart is our inner being. That God knows better than we know. Our heart is a very complex part of our being. And if it's properly aligned with God and His promises, there's power, there's blessing, there's freedom. The world around us frequently says, trust your heart. You know, if you're trying to make a decision, go with your gut. Just whatever your heart is telling you to do, do that. That's dangerous. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17, verse 9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? So would you trust something that's deceitful and sick? That's our human heart, unfortunately. That's our fallen human nature. People struggle with their heart. Even followers of Jesus struggle with self-condemnation. They struggle with guilt. They struggle with emotions that sometimes it's because of our human nature and we're more melancholic. Sometimes it's because of hurt and pain that we've experienced in life. Sometimes it's because of sin. But we wrestle with our heart. And verse 20, my page got mixed up. As we struggle with our heart, the Apostle John recognized that as followers of Jesus, we struggle with these emotions. We struggle from time to time from a hurting heart. We struggle with the condemnation sometimes that we have from our past. And John knew that the truth of God's word, if it's applied, it's like good medicine for our heart. God's word is truth that brings healing and truth to our heart. It realigns our heart with God's purposes, with His promises and His truth. So the question is, rather, how bold is your prayer life? The question should be, how is your heart? How's your heart today? What are you wrestling with today? What lies have you believed today? So turn with me to 1 John chapter 3. We're going to look at the last few verses of 1 John chapter 3, beginning at verse 18. Open your Bibles. We're going to look at this passage today at length. Well, that's not going to be long, but we'll go through the passage. So beginning of verse 18. Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him. Because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he has commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. Amen. You know, last week we looked at verse 18, and we looked at the importance of loving one another, and loving one another must flow from our heart. It must flow from our connection or our abiding in Christ. But to display love for one another, the final word in verse 18 says, in truth. That truth can only come from our heart if our heart is aligned with the promises of God's word. Verse 19 says, By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. Genuine, authentic love in action, caring for one another, assures us that we're children of God. If you're loving one another with no agenda, simply blessing one another, loving one another, that's an assurance that we are children of God. We have confidence in his presence as children of God. However, loving one another is not easy, is it? Nathan's just walked out, but Nathan was sharing with me this morning. He says, people are quirky, right? People just have some strange quirks about them sometimes, and it's hard to love people that aren't like us. But that's the body of Christ. We're all different. We all bring different expressions of our lives together, and sometimes it's hard to love one another because we do things that hurt one another. We say things that are taken the wrong way. There's endurance required to love. There's a persistence required to love one another. There's a constant pressing in and commitment to loving one another that's required. We had a great discussion in our life group this last week, and it was a lot of children and a lot of fun around the campfire. But one of the things that, well, the little fire we had, but one of the things that came out was, well, I've got a certain amount of love, right? And when that love is depleted, I have no love for each other. But where does the love come from? We have to rely on supernatural love to be able to love one another in the body of Christ. Richard Foster writes in his book, The Celebration of Discipline, in some ways, we would prefer to hear Jesus called to deny father and mother, houses and land for the sake of the gospel than his word to wash feet. Radical self-denial gives the feeling of adventure, but in service, we must experience the many little deaths that go beyond ourselves. Service banishes us to the mundane, the ordinary, the trivial. That's where it really gets challenging, to love one another in just the mundane, the trivial. Humble service gives us, though, the assurance that we belong to Jesus. Being able to serve beyond our capacity, to love beyond our capacity, because we're living from a transformed heart. That's the requirement. That's what God can do in our lives. We come to verse 20, and it seems a little confusing at first if you read verse 20. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Even though we know the scriptures, and maybe we've declared the gospel 100 times, we've heard the gospel 100 times, Sometimes we experience that self-condemnation. We experience those lies from the enemy, those whispers that Satan brings to us about our past and saying, remember that. People aren't going to accept you because of that. Or you cannot do this because remember what you did. We have to go back to the promises of God's word. It's all about his promises. 1 John 1 verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we apply that promise of God's word. He is faithful to forgive us. And then we go to Romans 8 verse 1. Now therefore there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. That's the promises of God's word. Just two simple promises, but it takes us from condemnation and doubt and fear to freedom and peace with God. We have to remember who we are in Christ. That's the key. Those two words, are you in Christ? Living from being in Christ, in communion with him and he with us. We stand before the all-knowing God. He is our Father, and he's good. But we're covered by the righteousness of Christ, not because we do anything, not because we have done any great thing, but because of his blood that cleanses us from all our sins. We're covered by the righteousness of God. Again, it's a heart issue. We can be misled by our emotions. We can be misled by our feelings. A number of you may remember Bill Bright, the founder of Campus Crusade, or CRU, and he had a booklet called The Four Spiritual Laws. And in that booklet, he used the illustration of a train, a steam engine. And the driver, the engine is faith. Not faith, the engine is the facts, the promises of God's word. And there's a somewhat interesting picture of it. But the engine has to be the facts of God's truth. That's the driver. What is the fuel? The fuel is the faith that God gives us to believe the promises of God. So we have the driver is the facts, the promises. God's word is the driver, the power that makes things move. The fuel is the faith to apply those promises. What has God said? Do I believe it? And that drives the train. At the back is the feelings, our emotions, those things that try to pull us off track. A lot of people are driven the other way around. They try to drive the engine with feelings. I get whiplash, but turning backwards and forwards because our emotions are up and down all the time because we're not moving in faith by the fact of God's promises and his word. God intends us to live by faith. The facts are who God says we are. It drives me crazy. So we have a beeping thing over here. The facts are God's, our God says who God says we are. We are purchased, we're redeemed, children of God. First Peter says that we are a royal priesthood. Our hearts, our emotions, our feelings can lie to us. How many of you have been experienced being lied to by your emotions and your feelings? I think we all have. That's why King David, I believe, he wrote in Psalm 139, "Search me, O God, and know my heart." What's going on in my heart? Try me and know my thoughts. So what lies are you believing? What lies are you believing? Oh, I've sinned too much for God to forgive me. I've kind of gone too far. God cannot forgive me. I've sinned too much. Or maybe I've done so much wrong in my life that God could never use me. I've disqualified to be used by God. Those are lies from the enemy. Oh, maybe I don't have the right education. God couldn't use me. I don't qualify. Maybe I'm not bold like other people, so there's no place for me in God's kingdom. Maybe I'm too poor, too weak, too old, whatever. Whatever lie has been spoken over your life that is disqualifying you in your feelings to be used by God. But what does God's promises say? What does God's word say about you? What are the facts Because those are the true facts. These promises, they follow in verse 21 and 22. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from Him because we keep His commandments and do what pleases Him. When we have confidence in our standing before God, When we have confidence in our standing before God, we can have confidence in our prayers, right? If you know who you are in Christ, you can be bold in your prayers because you know your Heavenly Father. You know where you stand with Him. John is saying that in these verses, God knows everything. He knows everything about you. There's nothing that's hidden from Him. And when we trust God with His promises, our consciences are clear. We can apply God's promises to our lives, the blood of Jesus, to cleanse us from all our sins. That's a promise from God's Word. It all comes back to two simple words, in Christ. Are we in Christ? Are we in Christ? As followers of Jesus, those who have given their lives to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, we can trust the promises of God. We're abiding in Christ. We're gaining our strength from His Spirit and His presence in us. Charles Spurgeon said, "He who has a clear conscience comes to God with confidence, and that confidence of faith ensures to him the answer of his prayer. Childlike confidence makes us pray as none else can. It makes a man pray for great things which he would never have asked for if he had not learned this confidence, and makes him pray for little things which a great many are afraid to ask for, because they have not yet felt towards God the confidence of children. The man of obedience is the man whom God will hear, because his obedient heart leads him to pray humbly and with submission, for he feels it to be his highest desire that the Lord's will should be done. Hence it is that the man or obedient heart prays like an oracle." His prayers are prophecies. Is he not one with God? Does he not desire and ask for exactly what God intends? How can a prayer shot from such a bow ever fail to reach its target? That's bold praying. Believers who have the confidence of knowing who we are in Christ can pray boldly, abiding in Christ. You know, we have that relationship with God, the relationship that comes like a child with his Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father who is good. Sadly, many Christians, many of us here today even, we're living for the commandments of God. We're wanting to know, what are the rules? What are the rules that I need to apply to my life in God's Word or in Christianity, in a church, let's say? What are the rules in this church? So that if I obey all the rules, do all the right things, then when I pray, God's going to answer my prayers. And we try to live by commandments, and God says, no, I want you to live by promises. Stop trying to live by the commandments. Live by the promises of God's Word. And then from those promises, our faith grows. Our belief grows. And we live every day in a pure relationship with God. And then as we're in relationship with Him, our desire is to do what He wants us to do. Our desire becomes His will. And then we live out of obedience because of the promises. So what are you living, how are you living today, in fear or in law or in love and relationship? Are you living out of fear, trying to obey the law, or are you living out of relationship and love for God? Verse 23 says, there's one commandment, just one thing that we need to obey to begin with. And this is His commandment, that we believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as He commanded us. It all begins and ends with belief in Jesus Christ. To be in Christ, that's what it means. The word to believe means to trust, to rely on, to use as our secure foundation. That's to believe. It's relational. It's personal. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Do you believe that Jesus came 2,000 years ago, was born in a manger? Do you believe that Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life? Do you believe that Jesus went to the cross willingly as a sacrifice for our sins, that His blood is able to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness? Do you believe that Jesus rose again on the third day? Do you believe that Jesus ascended into heaven where He's at the right hand of the Father now interceding for you? Do you believe that Jesus is coming again to take His church to be with Him? That's belief in the promises of God. Out of belief in Jesus, out of our relationship with our Father, we will love one another. Believe in Jesus Christ. Love one another. It's the most important thing. I quoted this verse last week. The night that Jesus was betrayed in the upper room, He speaks to His disciples, John 13. He says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." In 1991, there was a movie that came out, some of you may know it, called City Slickers. Do you remember that? Nope. Everybody in the first service knew that. Yeah, they've got some heads. And it's an interesting story. I don't know if I can recommend it, because it's been a long time since I've seen it, so I don't know how clean it is. But there's every now and then in a movie, there's a line that just grabs me as a biblical truth. And there was some biblical truth in this one. But I'll take it out of context. But if you remember in the movie, there was this hardened old cowboy by the name of Curly, played by Jack Palance. And Curly would take these guys from, this particular group was from New York City, and they were businessmen. And the one guy played by Billy Crystal was 39 years old at the time, and he was wrestling with life and wanting to know, what's the meaning of life and why am, you know, and so they went on this cowboy drive, cattle drive, to experience life, to try and find the meaning of life. And he's riding along with Curly and says, "What's the meaning of life?" And Jack Palance holds up his finger like that and says, "This one thing is the meaning of life, this one thing." And so Billy Crystal's really excited, says, "Well, what is that one thing?" And he says, "That's for you to find out. That's for you to find out." Well, the truth is, as followers of Jesus, we know what the one thing is. We know what that one thing is. There's no mystery. There's no mystery in it. As followers of Jesus, it's to love Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And out of that will flow life in our abiding in Him. John Piper wrote, concerning verse 23, he wrote, "The one all-embracing commandment of this letter is that we believe and that we love. These are the foundations of our assurance, because these are the evidence of God's work. They are the testimony of His Spirit." It's the one thing. David knew his purpose. Psalm 27, verse 4, "One thing have I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple." David was, he knew the one thing. He'd done so many great things in his life, he'd done so many shameful things in his life, but he knew the promise of God, this one thing. What is he asking for? And I believe that in the New Testament we have a word that encompasses the one thing. It's abiding. It's abiding in Christ and Him abiding in us. Remember, as we've looked at this word to abide that John loves to use, it's to be rooted in, to be established in, to be immovable, to gain nutrients from, like a tree planted in a garden, to abide. Verse 24, we read, "Whoever keeps His commandments abides in God and God in him. And by this we know that He abides in us by the Spirit whom He has given us." The Spirit of God is given to us. And by the Holy Spirit, we abide in God. That's the transaction. We abide in Him and as He abides in us. That abiding is a steadiness. There's security in abiding. Are you abiding in Christ? No matter what happens in the world around you, the rug may be pulled out from under your feet. Are you abiding? There's security in abiding. The presence of the Holy Spirit is not something that we can earn. It's not something that if we do enough good things, we gain more. And no, the presence of the Holy Spirit is a gift from God. Amen. And as we abide in Him, we have that security, that peace, that knowing God. And as we come to know God, we come to know Him as a good Father, as our Heavenly Father. Yes. J.I. Packer, in his classic called Knowing God, he writes, "What matters supremely is not the fact that I know God, but the larger fact that He knows me. I'm graven in the palms of His hands. I'm never out of His mind." Have you thought about that? "All my knowledge of Him depends on His sustained initiative in knowing me. I know Him because He first knew me and continues to know me. He knows me as a friend, one who loves me, and there's no moment when His eye is off me." That's truth. "Or His attention's distracted from me, and no moment, therefore, when His care falters. This is momentous knowledge. There is unspeakable comfort. There's tremendous relief in knowing that His love to me is utterly realistic, based at every point on prior knowledge of the worst about me, so that no discovery now can disillusion Him about me in the way I am so often disillusioned about myself, and quench His determination." Determination. God is determined to bless you. We disqualify ourselves because of the lies that we believe. God knows everything. Everything about you. As I said in the beginning, prayer is an outflow of our relationship with God. Prayer must flow from the relationship with God, knowing who He is. And we can come boldly before the throne. We can come boldly before Him because He's good. And His resources are unlimited. He'll never run out. You know, as I was reading what J.I. Packer wrote, I thought, but if His eye is always on me, is His eye on Dan? Is His eye on Bob? No, that's why He's God. His eye is on you all the time. There's never a moment that He's not thinking about you. Think about that. God loves you. He is love. How bold is your prayer life? Are you praying like a child who has absolute confidence in your Heavenly Father? Or are you praying out of duty? Well, I guess I'm supposed to pray. Are you praying out of superstition? Well, if I say certain words, then maybe God can do this and that on my behalf. If I get the right wording, maybe it'll work. No, it's out of relationship. God is good. You know, we have imperfect fathers. Every one of us has had an imperfect father. Now, our fathers were good to us, some weren't so good to us, but nothing can compare to our Heavenly Father. He is perfect, and we can trust Him. He is love. He is generous. So we're going to move into communion, sharing the Lord's Supper together. But I want us today to spend time boldly praying, and we'll do that at the end of the service. But now as we come to this table, I want us to prepare our hearts. I want us to come and apply the promises of God's Word to our hearts. So if the Lord has been speaking to you right now about a sin you need to confess, something that you need to make right, I want us to spend a few moments just realigning our hearts with God's purposes, realigning our hearts with the promises of God's Word. So let's do that as Dan plays, and then we come with grateful hearts as we remember His death and resurrection. So let's quietly, wherever you are, just let's pray and ask the Lord to prepare us and cleanse us and restore us.